subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Good evening, welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Johnson. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Tuesday, the 14th of December. Terrorists neutralized in India's Jammu and Kashmir, death toll rises to 3 in Srinagar terror attack. Ad hoc employees protest in Pakistan-administered Kashmir to demand job regularization. And no punishment for US troops involved in deadly Kabul strike, says Pentagon. And now for all the details. Security forces neutralized one terrorist in an encounter that broke out in Poonch district of India's Jammu and Kashmir on Tuesday. Meanwhile, the death toll climbed to 3 on Monday's deadly terror attack on a police bus in Srinagar city that was claimed by Pakistan-based Jaish-e-Mohammed terror group.
Security forces on Tuesday neutralized one terrorist during a gun battle in Poonch district of India's Jammu and Kashmir, a day after a deadly terror attack on a police bus in Srinagar city. The encounter broke out in the early hours of Tuesday in Suran Court area, and the operations were still underway till the last reports came in. Meanwhile, the death toll in Srinagar police bus attack reached 3 on Tuesday, as another cop succumbed to injuries, Vijay Kumar, the Kashmir Valley's police chief, informed as he paid floral tributes to the slain personnel. Monday's attack had been carried out by at least 3 terrorists from the Pakistan-based Jaish-e-Mohammed terror group, and a massive hunt was underway to nab the terrorists, the official said.
इस अब टोटल 3 शहीद हो गए, बाकी आउट ऑफ डेंजर है। ये जैश मोहम्मद ने खुद भी क्लेम किया, जैश मोहम्मद का टेररिस्ट इन्वॉल्व है।
Meanwhile, activists of Jammu West Assembly Movement staged an anti-Pakistan protest in Jammu City on Tuesday over Pakistan's alleged role in spreading terrorism in the Union Territory. In the wake of the Srinagar terror attack, India has long accused Pakistan of aiding and infiltrating terrorists from across the border to spread unrest in Kashmir Valley. Islamabad, however, denies the charges.
The ongoing winter session of the Indian Parliament on Tuesday witnessed scenes of chaos as opposition leaders protested to seek the revocation of suspension of 12 lawmakers. The opposition parties also staged a walkout and took out a march after Vice President Venkaiah Naidu refused to revoke the suspension over unruly behavior.
Amid the ongoing winter session of the Indian Parliament on Tuesday, the upper house witnessed another chaos as the opposition parties demanded revocation of the suspension of 12 lawmakers. The 12 lawmakers were suspended for the remainder of the winter session for their unruly and violent behavior on the last day of the monsoon session on August 11. The opposition parties staged a walkout after the Vice President Venkaiah Naidu refused to revoke the suspension. More than 18 opposition parties led by the Congress Party also took out a march from the Parliament House to Vijay Chowk in capital New Delhi in protest.
आज हमारे जो opposition के suspended MPs हैं, उनके 14 दिन suspension के हो गए हैं. House में जिन चीजों के बारे में opposition डिबेट करना चाहती है वो डिबेट सरकार नहीं होने देती है.
Meanwhile, India's Union Parliamentary Affairs Minister Prahlad Joshi said that the suspended lawmakers should express regret and the opposition leaders should express remorse over creating ruckus in the house. The opposition parties have been relentlessly disrupting the parliament proceedings almost every day over the issue, barring a few occasions.
Moving on, Scores of government employees in Pakistan-administered Kashmir have continued their protest against the repeal of a law that earlier regularized an unspecific number of ad hoc employees. Strongly condemning the move, a committee of the disgruntled ad hoc employees has warned the government of massive demonstrations, as they blamed the revoking of the law has rendered several of them jobless.
Scores of ad hoc government employees in Pakistan-administered Kashmir have continued to protest against the repeal of a law by the newly formed Pakistan Tehrik-e-Insaf government that earlier regularized an unspecified number of employees. The protesters claim that due to the changes through an ordinance, hundreds of employees who were appointed after December 2020 have been rendered jobless. They warned of holding massive region-wide demonstrations if the employees ripped off their permanent government positions were not regularized again.
जो 20-20 साल से 19-19 साल से 18-18 साल से इस इंतजार में बैठे हुए हैं यहाँ आजाद कश्मीर के अंदर मार्च हुए सरकारी मुलाजमतों के और कोई ऐसी फैक्ट्री नहीं है कोई ऐसा प्राइवेट सिस्टम नहीं है कि जहाँ लोग रोजगार के मौके जो है वो हासिल कर सके.
A committee of ad hoc employees had earlier blamed that this is not the case in Pakistan, where scores of employees have been regularized as per the previous legislation, but the people in the illegally occupied region still do not have access to equal rights and have to face exploitation.
The Pentagon said on Monday that no U.S. military personnel would be held accountable for the August 29 drone strike in Afghan capital Kabul that killed 10 civilians, including 7 children. Spokesperson John Kirby noted the high level of the threat facing U.S. forces following a deadly bombing outside the Kabul airport that killed 13 troops, context that he said was important.
The Pentagon said on Monday that no U.S. military personnel would be held accountable for the August 29 drone strike in Kabul that killed 10 civilians, including 7 children. An earlier investigation by the Air Force Inspector General had said the strike was caused by execution errors and communication breakdowns, and the military called it a tragic mistake. Pentagon spokesperson John Kirby told reporters that senior commanders had made a number of recommendations to Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin about the incident, none of which included any accountability measures for specific personnel.
What we saw here was a breakdown in process, and execution in procedural events, not the result of negligence, not the result of misconduct, not the result of poor leadership.
Kirby noted the high level of the threat facing U.S. forces following the bombing outside the Kabul airport that killed 13 troops as they withdrew from Afghanistan, context that he said was important. While the Pentagon has said it is working to offer condolence payments and relocation to the family of Afghans killed in the strike, it is still in talks with an aid organization that employed one of the victims.
The National Museum of Afghanistan in capital Kabul has reopened for the first time since the Taliban seized power in the capital on August 15. Reports suggest the members of the Taliban are now guarding the building that contained artifacts it once tried to smash through.
Afghanistan's National Museum has finally been reopened for visitors from home and abroad to introduce the country's history and civilizations for the first time since the Taliban seized power in August. The museum houses artifacts dating from the Paleolithic period around 4400,000 to 1200,000 BC to the 20th century. Although the museum is open for visitors, the number of visitors is still limited as many are unaware about the reopening of the museum.
It's just freshly opened. It's 3 days or 4 days that it's opened, and we do not have a lot of foreign visitors. Of course, I mean, the local people, especially people from the villages, they are very happy to come and see the museum.
The museum was once badly damaged as many of its collections had been looted during the factional fighting in the 1990s. The war-weary Afghans witnessed a political transition as the Taliban took over the capital, Kabul, on August 15 and announced the formation of a caretaker government on September 7. Meanwhile, the director of the National Museum of Afghanistan said during the recent political change in the country, luckily, nothing has been stolen, nothing has been broken, and nothing has been damaged in the museum. He exuded happiness that museum authorities were able to provide better security and safety of the collections. Despite reopening of the museum, it has been reported that like many civil servants of Afghanistan, the museum staff had not received their salaries since August.
Moving on to news from Bangladesh. Bangladeshi Prime Minister's Advisor for Information and Communication Technology Affairs Sajib Wasid Joy Sunday inaugurated the 5G or fifth generation mobile services via a state-run cell phone operator Teletalk in collaboration with Chinese telecom giant Huawei. Teletalk launched the service at the country's 6 sites on a trial basis. With the launch of the next generation services, mobile users in selected places in parts of Bangladesh will now have access to high-speed 5G internet through their mobile phones at a relatively lower price. Huawei Bangladesh provided infrastructure and technical support to Teletalk for deploying 5G networks. The private operators are expected to introduce the 5G next year after the auction for spectrum in March. 5G is the fifth generation technology standard for broadband cellular networks. Phone companies began deploying the 5G services worldwide in 2019. Northern India shivers under intense cold wave conditions as dipping temperatures and cold weather continue to tighten its grip across the region. Snowfall in the mountains has also affected the plains, including capital New Delhi, forcing people to take support of hot cups of tea and layers of clothing to beat the cold weather.
Parts of North India are under the grip of an intense cold wave, with dense fog enveloping several areas. In Shimla town of northern Himachal Pradesh state, the temperature plummeted to 2.7 degrees Celsius on Tuesday, affecting day-to-day activities of the people of the hill station. People were seen huddled around bonfires to fight the cold and keep themselves warm. The temperature across Himachal Pradesh has plunged suddenly after the snowfall, with temperature in many places remaining below minus 10 degrees Celsius. Meanwhile, amid deteriorating air quality, the residents of capital New Delhi woke up to shallow fog on Tuesday morning with low visibility. The air quality remained in the very poor category on Tuesday, according to forecasting bodies Suffer. Snowfall in the mountains has added chilling cold in the plains, including New Delhi. The minimum temperature is set to dip further by early next week, the IMD India Meteorological Department forecast showed. People took support of hot cups of tea and bonfires to beat the cold weather. Some locals said due to the cold, their routine chores were getting delayed, hence disrupting work. By December 20, the minimum temperature could fall to 5 degrees Celsius and the maximum to 21 degrees Celsius. In northern holy city of Ayodhya, servitors have adorned the deities in temples with woolen clothes. As mercury levels continue to drop with onset of winter, deities too are believed to have life in them. Some priests say it is devotion rather than cold that has the gods decked up in winter warmth.
Well, that's the way it was in South Asia this evening. Before we conclude the top stories once again. Terrorists neutralized in India's Jammu and Kashmir. Death toll rises to 3 in Srinagar terror attack. Ad hoc employees protest in Pakistan-administered Kashmir to demand job regularization. And no punishment for US troops involved in deadly Kabul strike, says Pentagon. Now our viewers can watch the show on SouthAsiaNewsline.com, You can also visit us on facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter at AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.